Mr. Brightside from the Killers, which is, and that'll be a real particular distorted, ultra distorted bass sound. And then we're going to work on, just start a piece from scratch with Hadrien, just doing kind of a jazz piece as well that he'll build out with a few basses. And I'd like to show you the different ways we would mic these and try to get sound for them. So this first song that we're going to start with, you know, we're going to try this bass. We're not sure if this is going to work, this bass and this amp, because I don't know if it'll be distorted enough.
Yeah.
Generally, when I'm miking basses, I'll take a direct, which is right down there. I'll take a DI. We'll have a main mic on the cabinet, and we also do this NS10, which is, we use as like a sub mic. One thing that's very important that we'll have to check when we get in there is, like, you'll see we line this speaker right up with the middle of this microphone, so the diaphragms and this speaker are exactly in line. Because if you put this out here, they're gonna be slightly out of phase, and you're gonna start getting like a comb filter. It'll sound like it's going through a phase shifter. So we put that, and then we'll have to check the phase on the direct with both of these as well, to make sure everything's in phase. Otherwise, you got no bottom or all your middle go. I see a lot of people will do double mic a cabinet, and they'll put a mic here and they'll put some out here or out in the room a little bit. Sometimes that can be cool, but a lot of times what happens is it just gets this, it sounds like a phase shifter a little bit. You get a comb filter. So we always tend to line, when we do multiple mics on guitar cabinets as well, we line them up exactly. When we get in the other room, I'll show you, if these are in phase, I'll flip it out so you can hear what it sounds like out of phase. Because if you don't know, sometimes you'll be recording it and you can't figure out why you can't hear the bass. You get a little clicky highs and some real low subs. So I'll show you what that sound is.
First thing we need
with a bass,
good bass player with the bass.
Yeah, you know? Right. it might help.
Yeah, maybe play and just play. Let me just see what we sound like here, real quick. That's just the direct. That's the sound of that NS10. So that's if I start with the DI, there's a DI. There's the microphone in. There's the sub.
Done.
There's the sub out. mean, the reason I use the sub and the fat is there's without the sub. That's without the sub. That big extra fat. The NS10s it's a capsule of a micro that size, and the NS10s is this big thing. It's a subwoofer. And in a mix, I mean, I have all three of those separate. In a mix, I might not want all that sub, depending what else is going on, but it's nice if you want to get that bass. It's just fat, you know. On this particular song, this is probably still too dull. This particular song we record, we would probably have brighter and more distorted, so we might... bright enough. We're just going to play the track, have him play along, and try to see if I can get a sound that's fitting. Played with the pick, and another Fender bass, and just kind of compare. I mean, it's really important to find the bass that's going to sound the best and really cut through. Because the rest of this particular track is really distorted, and you have to find something the bass plays a really important part in the song. So you have to find something that'll be distorted but really keep a nice full bottom. Just to struggle with this one. We're using. Right now on the mics and the DI, we're using, you guys can't really see them here, but we're using, we have these three Neve preamps that we're using over here, which are off the
Neve, right?
These are old Neve 1073s. I like those on bass, kick drums and snares a little better than the SSL pre's.
Mm-hmm.
can't really mute because there's this.
He's having trouble with the pick, playing with the pick with that pick.
I mean, it's okay. It's just if I ever want to to just control a little bit, like the strings ringing and all that, and then go. So now,
when I placed the mics, I don't know if you guys saw me out there, I kind of set them up for Mark the way that he normally puts them on there. So I usually put that FET 47, which is the condenser mic that we're using, the small diaphragm microphone, mm-hmm. about an inch off the grill of the amp. Mm-hmm. And then if you look on the amp with a flashlight, you can see there's the cone right in the center, and there's a crease, like a very visible crease. We usually mm-hmm. point the capsule of the mic kind of right at the crease.
Mm-hmm.
The closer you get towards the cone, the brighter the sound. The farther away you get from the cone, the duller the sound.
Mm-hmm.
So that's the one he's using to kind of drive the top end. So we did that, and then the subwoofer we kind of placed just off to the side, right on the same, you know, alignment with the capsule of mm-hmm. the other mic, mm-hmm. and it's picking up more of the low end from mm-hmm. the speaker. So that's how we placed the microphone.
Close my cabinet in this big of a room. If it was in a small, really small room, it mm-hmm. might make a difference where you put it. But in this big of a room, there's not much mm-hmm. reflection coming back.
But what would you do if you ain't had another bass? What would you do then?
If you had no substitution? One that I had work.
Yeah.
I mean, you work when I recorded and mixed this song, we had basically some SM57s, and I had to mix it on a little 8-channel mixer. And I've had 3 or 4 plugins, so we had nothing to make this song. But you use what you have, but it still managed to sell 10 million records, despite lack of good equipment.
But in this kind of music, in this kind of genre, how big will be the influence of the way the player picks the notes? How strong shall it influence on the mix, on the sound, in the end of the day?
A big influence. The technique of the bass player is the same as the technique of a drummer. I can have 3 different bass players play the same part, and one of them will sound great, and the other two will be... I've had 2 drummers play the exact same part on the same kit. One of them is one of the best studio drummers in LA, and the other was just a guy in the band. And the difference was the drums go from like, crap, I don't know what they sound like, boxes.
Yeah.
And Matt Chamberlain goes out and plays, and it's like, oh, crap, this is wonderful. I mean, it always starts, it's always starting with a vocal, guitar, bassing. It's always starting with the guy who's playing it. If he's not playing the part that really sits note-wise in, you know, into the area where he's supposed to be, or he's not playing, the timing's not great, or, you know, there's 100 different ways, but, but it always starts with the guy who's playing.
Do you sometimes use, not live bass, but some synthesized bass or analog bass, something?
I do both a lot. I will use synth bass, I'll use synth bass and verses going to a live bass in the chorus. Mm-hmm. Sometimes I'll do both together. That's doing two basses together is a little more difficult, just arrangement wise, to get make sure you don't get passing notes that rub, or have the synth bass playing either a higher part of the top and the electric bass is holding the bottom, or vice versa. But you just don't want to get them playing notes too close together, because you get a lot of beating in the low end. Let me play this for a second pre-chorus here. Just in the pre-choruses on this song, there is the live bass and a synth bass playing even on this one.